Content warning. This episode contains discussion of suicide, murder, violence, and addiction. If you're in the United States and dealing with suicidal thoughts, please call the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline at 988.
We love Niagara Falls. It is a beautiful area full of wonderful things to see and do. Yet, like any other part of the world, Niagara Falls and the surrounding counties are not free from crime and tragedy.
But if someone you love goes missing in Western New York, you have a strong advocacy group in your corner. Merry Williams-Diers has created an incredible network to help the loved ones of victims find the answers they need. After we read about her work in the Niagara Gazette, we decided to reach out to her to learn more about her work and some of the puzzling cases she has been involved with.
In this discussion, she will tell us about three cases, including one involving a woman whose remains were found near the remains of another person, one who had been killed years earlier. Was it possible that this was the dumping ground of a serial killer?
My name is Anya Kane. I'm a journalist.
And I'm Kevin Greenlee. I'm an attorney.
We first connected while looking into the Burger Chef murders, an Indiana cold case. Together, we built a spreadsheet documenting hundreds of cases of restaurant-related homicides. That original spreadsheet gave way to our podcast, The Murder Sheet.
Now we maintain that same research-centric, investigative approach as we look into all sorts of homicides, including unsolved cases, historical crimes, and, of course, restaurant murders.
We don't just chat about the headlines. Our podcast is a platform for our journalism. The Murder Sheet focuses on investigative reporting, thoughtful analysis, thorough research, and in-depth interviews. We're the Murder Sheet.
And this is Helping the Missing and Unidentified of Western New York with Merry Williams-Diers. Can you tell us a little bit about your background and how you got interested in true crime?
My name is Merry Williams-Diers, and I founded Western New York Missing and Unidentified Persons in February of 2021. And then I recently made the podcast Meddling in Mysteries, Murder and Missing on Mondays with Merry, where our first episode actually aired in March of 2023. I kind of got interested growing up in a small community. We had quite a few missing and unsolved cases here locally in Chautauqua County. And as I grew older, those cases kind of tended to remain unsolved. So you kind of get to know those families throughout the media releases throughout the years. And, you know, you just kind of have sympathy for them. So I felt like there was something that I could do to help fill that void or the gap or whatever, and started looking into NAMIS and different databases, and it kind of just went from there.
Do you actually work with the police at all?
I do. I am in pretty regular contact, actually, with Chautauqua County Sheriff's Office. They have a new cold case unit here. They're Unsolved Chautauqua on Facebook, and they recently just got funding to get two part-time detectives to kind of give these cold cases new eyes. And we did a fundraiser for them on National Missing Persons Day on February 3rd. We called it the Pasapalooza fundraising event, and we raised upward of $1,300 so that they can start trying to use new DNA advancements to their benefit. So we kind of wanted to kick that off with giving them some funding to do so, as they're waiting for pending grants and stuff to be secured, hopefully, so that they can continue with that.
That's very exciting. I wish more law enforcement had cold case units.
Yes, it took a lot of work on behalf of our Chautauqua County Sheriff, Jim Quattrone. It's something he had been working on for quite some time, and I believe they got started at the end of last year, if I'm not mistaken.
Have you also come to know some of the families who were involved in some of these cases?
Yes, that's actually where I started in all of this. I kind of touched base with a couple of the long-term missing here in Chautauqua County and, you know, asked them, is there anything new or have you heard anything recently? And we kind of all established relationships at different paces and throughout the years, but I got to know these families. And then when I got pretty heavily involved and did the Western New York Missing and Unidentified, is when one of our locals, Kevin Hornberg, went missing. And that's where I kind of stepped it up a notch. We organized community search efforts. As soon as he went missing here in Jamestown, we posted two candlelight vigils for him. And it kind of just went from there, unfortunately. There's too many families being affected by unsolved cases here in Chautauqua County. And the cold case unit kind of gave them new hope and a new breath of life that some of these families that have been waiting, some of them as far back as 1972.
In terms of, you know, stepping back a bit, in terms of the area we're talking about, Chautauqua County, what can you tell outsiders about this area who might not be familiar with it?
Well, Chautauqua County is pretty small. Our local town, Jamestown, has about 30,000 people in it. Everybody knows everybody. It's not somewhere that you would think would be a dangerous type of place until you really dive a little bit deeper into these unsolved cases. Over the years, a lot of people had rumors such as there might be a serial killer locally and stuff like that because of the amount of missing women and stuff in this area. But the closer that you really dig in, you realize that for the most part, there's somebody suspected in all of their cases and none of it being the same person, except for one of our most recent cases, which we actually plan on discussing today. But actually, none of them really tend to run into each other or are really connected in any way. But the only commonality that they have is they remain unsolved. The lack of evidence to really hold anybody accountable hasn't been found yet.
Well, let's start talking about some of these cases. One that you mentioned to us was Marquita Mull. Can you tell us about that case?
Yeah. So Marquita Mull, she, her sister actually contacted Western New York Missing and Unidentified in early June of 2021. And she told me that her sister had went missing. No one had really seen her since the Fillmore Broadway area in Buffalo, New York. So we started search parties out there for her. I have a Team Buffalo here in our Western New York teams. We kind of divided up by geography and we added her sister into Team Buffalo. And we, again, had boots on the ground immediately conducting some community organized searches, hanging flyers, asking people if they knew anything. Basically, not a lot of tips were generated from the searches. People said, yeah, we know her, but we haven't seen her. Not a lot of information came forward right away. And the next time that I was hearing about it is actually when Chautauqua County Sheriff Jim Quattrone reached out to me and said, do you have a family contact for Marquita? And that was after two unidentified remains had been found on our local Rails for Trails hiking path here in Chautauqua County, specifically the town of Portland. And so he reached out to family and they verified that one of those sets of remains was that of Marquita Mull. And since that time, I know they've been working with Buffalo Police Department since she went missing in Buffalo, and there's still not very much known about her case. It's now been almost 2 years, and the family, I know I stay in contact with her sister Wendy, and she hasn't heard anything just recently as far as any updates are concerned.
And one kind of unusual detail is that another body was found near Marquita. And those remains have not been identified, have they?
Correct. Yep, they were found within 10 yards of each other, and there are some common denominators, such as they were very close in proximity. But there are some differences in that the first one that was located was the one that we consider Rails for Trails, Jane Doe. And she had actually been buried And that was the first one that was found. Somebody was walking through the trail and dropped something and was looking for it and came across what she thought was a human skull and called the police. The following day, they were conducting a grid search to look for any additional information or evidence in regards to that case, and that is when they stumbled across Marquita Mull.
And the first Jane Doe, weren't there indications that those remains had actually been there for quite a while?
Yes. At first, they did say that they believed it to be decades old, but upon further testing, they are now saying that it could have been as soon as 2011. Of course, they could have been there prior to that, but that is the most recent year that I have heard that they do believe those remains have been there since.
Do police have any theories? Do they believe both these people were killed by the same person, or what's the thinking?
They won't say much in regards to that. They did do a press conference early on where they did say they're going where the evidence leads them, that they aren't going to start any theories or hearsay kind of thing, that they were indeed in close proximity. But until any evidence of that was found, they weren't going to speculate, and we haven't really heard much as far as an update since that time.
How hard is all of this on Marquita's family to not have answers as to what happened to their loved one?
It's devastating. First and foremost, Marquita was a vulnerable adult to begin with. She had previously been hit in a hit-and-run accident and had traumatic brain injury as it was. So Marquita already was trying to live the best life that she could. She still had a high quality of life, but she's not somebody that you would necessarily think anybody would have any ill will towards, or somebody that would be a high rate for a victim, really. She didn't do a lot. She didn't travel outside of Buffalo very often. She was very family oriented. She called her dad on a daily basis, called him hourly, basically updates when she took her medicine. I know it's been very hard for him. Her sister has bouts of depression, and she also struggles with lupus. So going through bouts of that and depression, I know it really takes her a toll on her. And at times she has to take a step back to try and process everything, especially with the lack of answers that there are for her right now.
Has law enforcement ever indicated if they have any persons of interest?
They have not. I did hear from Wendy herself that somebody had told her that they failed a lie detector test in regards to Marquita Mull, but I have kind of been asked to keep that zipped up for now because it is an ongoing investigation. They were actually kind of curious how I heard that, and rumors go, and that's all it takes is one person telling somebody something like that to that nature. And at the time, I don't think the family wanted to believe that. So they, you know, they went along with the fact that he was probably intimidated by law enforcement, and that's why he failed the lie detector test. But nothing further has come from that. He was asked not to leave New York State, however, and I have been told and looked at his Facebook to see that he has, but I got to keep that identification private for this time.
Yeah, of course, that makes sense. Do you, now that you've gotten involved in so many cases, I imagine there's probably often instances where you find out things that you have to keep private like that.
Yes, and it's very hard to keep things, especially when, you know, I go into this as an advocate for the missing person and their family. So I'm not necessarily an advocate on the behalf of law enforcement. So there are times where they're not overly happy with me, but they definitely work with me. They're more than supportive in what we do, but they aren't usually the ones that tell me much information. It comes from the families, from our community. And that's the thing. These rumors have been floating around as cold as these cases are, some from 18 to 50 years old. And the rumors have been existent this entire time. However, our community does have a tendency to withhold information from law enforcement, whether it be they have active warrants or they're just intimidated by law enforcement, or, you know, the old saying, snitches get stitches. So people really have a hesitancy to contact law enforcement directly. And that's where I kind of step in, because I'm from here, born and raised, and I've kind of built that level of trust within our community where people do tell me these things, come forward, and anything that I do learn is forwarded to law enforcement. However, we have ways to contact our group anonymously. And as I always say in the podcast, we don't really care who they are. We care what they know. So we aren't really looking to prosecute or anything like that. We're looking to locate our missing. So we always accept anonymous tips if you don't want involved or want your name in it, but you've heard something, seen something, or know something about a particular case. We always leave our anonymous tip line open at wnymissingandunidentified@yahoo.com. I also know that the sheriff's unit, the cold case unit, also took that same stance, and they also have a tip line available at unsolvedchautauqua@sheriff.us.
I'm curious, you know, given that you've been doing this work for a while now as a victim's advocate, I'm curious, how do you think that law enforcement, the media, and just society as a whole can better serve the families of some of these long missing, you know, cold cases and unidentified cases that you've sort of looked at?
Well, I think it would be great to start with legislation. New laws need to be put in place, I do believe, for everybody to have the commonality and the same standard as to how quickly you work such cases. It's so easy for somebody to be disregarded because they're either a repeat runaway or somebody that may not make daily contact with family. And everybody tends to think, oh, maybe they're, or even addicts, maybe they're out on a binge or something of that nature. And I don't think every case is treated as a potential homicide case within the first 48 hours, which proves to be pretty detrimental in the overall investigation. And that doesn't just go for our local law enforcement. I think that's kind of a problem nationwide, but especially here in New York State.
Another case you mentioned to us was Clarence Kelwaski. Am I pronouncing that correctly?
Yeah, Junior, yep.
Can you tell us about that case?
Yes, Clarence actually is from Jamestown, New York, so right here where I'm from. And he went into a drug treatment facility in Saratoga Springs. He had been there at least 6 weeks, and on August 10th, he left the facility. On August 11th, he called family from Saratoga Springs from a passerby's cell phone and asked them to pay for a ticket for him to return to Jamestown. There's word that he may have been told that he's looking at a long-term facility for upward of a year. Apparently, he didn't like that. He signed himself out of the rehab facility and was looking for transportation back to Jamestown. He actually lost connection on that phone call with his family, and they were willing to pay for his bus ticket back to town. However, the phone disconnected. He never called back. And the next time we heard anything was when there was a deceased individual located here in Jamestown on October 17th of 2022, which is his hometown. And police from the very beginning have been looking to see how he returned from Saratoga Springs to Jamestown. They have him on camera entering the AM track out there, but they never seen him exiting. However, they later stated that they do not believe he took public transportation back to Jamestown, and they believe that there's somebody here that went to go pick him up and bring him back to town. Nobody still knows the timeline or anything. Basically, nothing is known that wasn't known the day that he left and lost connection with his family other than he's deceased, unfortunately. Family just received autopsy reports, and they say that they were kind of misled, and they aren't very happy overall with not having any answers that they didn't have the day that he went missing. The cause of death was ruled undetermined, so that makes it kind of even harder. How can you find any kind of closure when you don't even know if it's homicide or if it was natural causes at this point? So they are still very much seeking answers. The investigation is ongoing through Jamestown Police Department. And Captain Samuelson is still looking for anybody that may have been that ride from Saratoga Springs back to Jamestown to get a better idea of the timeline, when he did make it back here, how he made it back here, and maybe steps that he made along the way. At this point, it's pretty mysterious and nobody seems to know very much, and the family is kind of more hopeless than ever, seeing that they didn't even get as much as a cause of death ruled. So they're pretty discouraged with all that they've learned this week, actually.
I can imagine. Do they suspect possible homicide?
I don't know if they know what to suspect, but they definitely think of the suspicious circumstances. There was some Prozac from the rehab facility still found in his system, as well as fentanyl, but not in lethal dosages. And how long that takes to exit the liver, it very well could have been from before he entered the rehab facility. And again, that wasn't lethal doses. But if he were to have passed away in that manner, family definitely wants to know who provided him that. We've seen recently a new trend taking place where if an overdose death does occur, that they kind of try to pursue charges, even if it's not murder, but, you know, being responsible or accountable in some way for providing somebody drugs that overall results in death. So we're hoping that trend stays with Clarence, and if that is determined to be his cause of death, that they pursue, still trying to figure out how he made it here, who he was with, and the company that he was keeping leading up to his death, as well as any other possibilities. His decomposition was in such an advanced state that they can't rule out a lot of things for natural causes either. So at this point, it's kind of a coin toss as to what happened to Clarence.
And it's just so horrible to think of his family on that, being on a phone call with him and then losing the connection. And that's the last time they hear the voice of their loved one.
Yes. And they were actually talking about going to Saratoga Springs, and we started kind of trying to circulate stuff in Saratoga Springs groups on Facebook, getting his face seen and heard. Basically, nobody had seen him. Nobody had heard from him there. And we don't have anybody here in Jamestown reporting that they've seen him return to Jamestown, but we know at some point he obviously did do that. I'm not usually refused media coverage here with our missing and unidentified. However, in that particular case, I have to say it was probably the first time I was denied coverage, in that they said he went missing from Saratoga Springs. They don't have a strong following that way. And there was no evidence saying that he ever made it back to Jamestown. So that story never got published, unfortunately. So the first time people are being asked, did you see Clarence return? Do you know when he returned? Do you know where he was at or where he was frequenting at the time? Those answers just never came, because they basically didn't publicize that he even was missing until he was located deceased, unfortunately. His sister did get an article published out there near Saratoga Springs, but as far as local media, it kind of went uncovered until the discovery was made.
Speaking of the media, can you talk us through your experience trying to get some of these cases publicized and sort of the media environment there, some of the challenges, but also some of the benefits of doing that?
Absolutely. We have a great local media. I always say that I can't do what I do without our media, without our Western New York community, and without a mighty God leading the way, because we aren't super expertise. We don't have a ton of training. All we are community volunteers that wish to make a difference. But our media has been great. They show up to every time I've called them, aside from Clarence specifically. They show up to all of our candlelight vigils. They promote our events, our fundraisers. You're not really denied anything. Worst case scenario, sometimes they can't be on scene due to something bigger or something else happening previously. Obligations that they need to attend to, but they're even willing to do an after story if you take a picture from the event and give them kind of some of what occurred and what took place. They're willing to do stories to advertise the stuff, whether they can be there or not, and they've been really good to us. We have the local Jamestown Post Journal, which has a journalist, Eric Pitchy, that is how you guys kind of heard about me and seen me, is because he published an article into what we do, because he's been following us and coming to these events for 2+ years. And unfortunately, it's been quite a bit of them. We've done 2 candlelights for Kevin, and we have our first one coming up for Clarence actually this May. So we were already in touch with him about covering that, and now we feel that's more important than ever for the family to receive answers. We also do have local media sometimes as far as Buffalo reaching out, because we cover the 8 counties that make up Western New York. And some of these cases originate, like Marquita Mull, in Buffalo, and then are located here in Chautauqua County or vice versa. So We've had media come to Jamestown to cover us from Buffalo, Rochester, and they've been really good to us, like I said. There's not one case that I've started from beginning to end that you can't Google and find multiple news sources for. So they've been very good to our group.
You've done a wonderful job, though, kind of spearheading that and kind of getting people to do that coverage. And I'm curious, would there be any advice that you had for a victim's family, a missing person's family, or perhaps even a family advocate somewhere who's kind of trying to get that process started on how to approach the media and raise awareness?
Don't wait. There's a lot of reasons sometimes people choose not to go forward right away, whether it is circumstances leading up to that person's disappearance, possibly their relative being an addict and not wanting to publicize that information. We do sometimes have the stereotypical cases where we feel they aren't taken seriously because there's a label put on these people from the very beginning. So these families kind of shut down and don't want to publicize sometimes their private matters. And what we recommend to them is all of it comes to light eventually. It's better to get the word out there sooner than later. It's good to get boots on the ground immediately. A huge thing that's solving cases now in 2023 that we didn't have back then is video surveillance, but there are still limitations to even the most modern of technologies in that sometimes footage is overwritten within 2 weeks' time if it's not requested and reviewed, which we have canvas areas with our missing people and requested video footage surveillance. However, we can't review that personally. That goes directly to the police department to review. And sometimes it's just not tipped off that there's a camera in that area in time. Like I said, a lot of these cases just aren't treated as a possible homicide within the first 24 to 48 hours. And by the time they've been taken seriously, oh, it's not somebody that just chose to leave town and isn't coming back or isn't a repeat runaway. And this person is really gone. Sometimes as much as 3 or 4 weeks has passed already. And that's very crucial timing in the case of both missing persons and unsolved cases.
The last case we're going to discuss, I may be mispronouncing this name, it's Saniyaa Dennis?
Yes, 19-year-old Saniyaa Dennis. And I actually wanted to discuss her because you guys said that you've seen my work in Niagara Falls. So I figured we'd pick a Niagara Falls case to discuss. And that one tends to be the most controversial Niagara Falls case that I've dealt with since I started doing this. 19-year-old Saniyaa Dennis was a SUNY Buffalo State College student, and she went missing in the early hours of April 24th, 2021. It was later proven that she traveled to Niagara Falls via NFTA bus, and she also took a selfie picture around Goat Island, and that's believed to be her last known location. The family wasn't from around here. They're actually from New York City area. Bronx, Yonkers areas. So they had to travel all the way up here, which again, like I said, that time frame and the early investigation is so crucial, even to non-law enforcement, people willing to help to immediately start searching. There were a couple days delayed because the family had to travel up here. But they feel like her case was mishandled from the very beginning. And by the end of it, DA John Flynn concluded that Saniyaa Dennis committed suicide, and the family disputes that and says she is still actively missing and that they have insufficient proof to make that claim or make that conclusion that she committed suicide. So we still treat her as a very active missing persons case. The more you look into Niagara Falls, actually, you kind of realize that that would be an easy way to get away with murder or something of that nature, foul play, because the minute that a vehicle is located near Niagara Falls or somebody visiting Niagara Falls or seen on video surveillance, which there aren't many of them actually for being a state park. That's something we were advocating for after she went missing. One of the pieces of evidence that DA Flynn brought up to conclude that is that they showed the family a small dot on a video surveillance claiming that was her entering the park. But really, you can't make out that it was Saniyaa Dennis. Being a New York State Park, we expect our people to be safe going in there or at least have answers as to what happened. A lot of what they do know actually came from social media. She had taken a picture, I believe, on Snapchat, and somebody shared that within our group the night that she had went missing. And after 24 hours, those stories delete and stuff. But her friend just happened to think that was weird and screenshotted it and shared that with us later. The other evidence that DA Flynn used to come to that is they used canines. The canines wanted to immediately jump over the fencing, basically at Niagara Falls, around where she was last seen, indicating that she had jumped from that area. But again, that comes down to there wasn't video surveillance on her. If or when she did jump, how do we know she wasn't pushed? How do we know she didn't meet up with anybody there at the park? There were text messages between her and family that day where she seemed upbeat. However, they say that she had text messages with a boyfriend or an ex-boyfriend discussing possible suicide, but said that she had changed her mind type of thing. So a lot of the evidence in her case is circumstantial. They call it evidence, but the family says that's a lot of room for error, and they still want more solid answers. And like I said, there's a lot of cases in Niagara Falls that it's suspected that they jumped or suspected suicide, but that leaves a big window and lack of answers for these families trying to prove that, being that I know when the family went there to search, a lot of the cameras weren't functioning, and being a state park, I know that we need to advocate for things like that. So those are areas that we also try to fill in the gap and advocate for, you know, better. Even in cases that we start out thinking there might be foul play and it does end up being either natural causes or suicide, you expect to have that answer. It's still a lot to figure out in a family's brain, even once you have a definite answer, but that's not sufficient evidence in the family's eyes and a lot of our community's eyes, because a lot of people have been suspected of going over Niagara Falls. But we also know Niagara Falls is a huge hub. It basically connects between New York to the Canadian border. So there's that border right there. There's the New York PA border nearby, as well as it's known for sex trafficking hubs and things of that nature. A lot of young, pretty women go missing in Niagara Falls that are never seen or heard from again. And it would be as easy as somebody going to park their vehicle and sending a text message off to family to make it appear as a suicide. So a lot of those cases, a lot of the families still don't have complete closure that their family member chose to end their life or something like that.
And then one impression that I think Kevin and I have always gotten about Niagara Falls, and correct us if this is maybe a misperception, is that there is an effort, or at least, you know, there's kind of an inclination to not publicize the rate of alleged suicides, essentially, because, I mean, there might be good reason for that because you don't want to encourage that. But by not talking about some of these issues, it also seems like, as you said, it's opening the door for, you know, is it a suicide or maybe something else going on? By not talking about the issue, it sort of seems like that's leaving that door open, I guess.
Yeah, absolutely. Not talking about it doesn't solve any problems. And the fact is that a lot of these natural areas, such as Niagara Falls, the Grand Canyon, are already high suicide rates without us discussing it, without us talking about it. That's a fact. So I feel like we need to be more proactive than reactive. I know we used to have people that would kind of stroll these parks, which we lost funding for that quite a while ago. I've heard them talk about emptying the falls. I think they were supposed to do that somewhere around 2017, and due to COVID, it never happened. And to this day, we still hope that happens sometime. There are still people from the first time that they emptied Niagara Falls that they still haven't identified to date. And to me, that tells me lack of resources because of new modern day DNA. You know, even one skeletal remain can possibly lead to the identification of a person and give one family answers. And with places like such high rates, to me, it should be more trying to get these answers before they happen. To hear that a lot of the cameras weren't acting in our New York State Park, we all pay taxes, and where is that tax money going to these state parks if it's not to keep us safe, it's not for extra eyes and ears around the park, and if it's not for the cameras, it kind of makes you wonder where those resources are going, and it seems like we're actually losing resources rather than gaining them in such important areas. And still having, like, again, I say 2023, our video surveillance is pretty good these days, where you should be able to recognize somebody entering the park rather than saying, this black blob, we believe, is your daughter entering the park. I mean, we feel like there should be better at this time.
This has been really great, and I feel like we've gotten so many insights on your work and these cases, and I just want to say thank you, and thank you for the work you're doing. If people want to get involved, if they want to support your mission and the work you're doing, what's a good way of doing that?
You can always find me on Facebook under Merry Williams-Diers, the Western New York Missing and Unidentified Persons page. We have the anonymous tip line that I encourage anybody to send us emails, even if it's not anonymous or you want to get involved and you prefer that method of contact. Again, that is wnymissingandunidentified@yahoo.com, or reach out to me on my cell phone at 716-401-2080. We have teams across Western New York, so I can add you to the one closest to you. And we're always looking to expand that team. And likewise, thank you guys for helping me be a voice for the voiceless and expand it more nationwide than just our community. We appreciate that help and all the advocates coming together to kind of get these heard and elevated to another level.
Well, we appreciate you talking with us. And as Anya said, we appreciate the work you do. Can you tell us one more time the name of your podcast and how people can find it?
Yes, it's a page on Facebook called Meddling in Mysteries, Murder and Missing on Mondays with Mary. You can just search it in the type bar. You should be able to find us. If not, we do kind of cross-post between that and Western New York Missing and Unidentified Persons. So they should be able to find us on either platform, and we post from both accounts. So they should, or even my Facebook has both of those links available to them.
We want to thank Mary again for taking the time to talk with us. We hope to have her on again soon. Meanwhile, if you want to keep up with Mary and her efforts on behalf of the missing in Western New York, we've included links in our show notes. Thanks so much for listening to The Murder Sheet. If you have a tip concerning one of the cases we cover, please email us at murdersheet@gmail.com. If you have actionable information about an unsolved crime, please report it to the appropriate authorities.
If you're interested in joining our Patreon, that's available at www.patreon.com/murdersheet. If you want to tip us a bit of money for records requests, you can do so at www.buymeacoffee.com/murdersheet. We very much appreciate any support.
Special thanks to Kevin Tyler Greenlee, who composed the music for The Murder Sheet, and who you can find on the web at kevintg.com.
If you're looking to talk with other listeners about a case we've covered, you can join the Murder Sheet discussion group on Facebook. We mostly focus our time on research and reporting, so we're not on social media much. We do try to check our email account, but we ask for patience as we often receive a lot of messages. Thanks again for listening.